That disturbance, of course, alerted people in the 6 boulevards and 3 marts, the firemen and guards living in various stations. The reports went quickly to the regional patrol commander and the East City Warden's office. Since this was an affair for which they had to assume responsibility, the commander and the warden at once summoned the cavalry and archers to pursue the thieves out of the city. When the thieves saw how strong the government troops were, they dared not contend with them. Putting down the huge wardrobe and abandoning the white horse, they fled in every direction. The government troops did not manage even to catch half a thief, but they did take the wardrobe and caught the horse, and they returned in triumph. As he looked at the horse beneath the lights, the commander saw that it was a fine creature indeed. Its mane parts like silver threads. Its tail dangles as strips of jade. Why mention the 8 noble dragon steeds? This one surpasses Su Xiang's slow trotting. Its bones would fetch 1,000 gold. This wind chaser threw 10,000 miles. He climbs mountains oft to join the green clouds. Neighs at the moon, and fuses with white snow. Truly a dragon that has left the isles. A jade unicorn that man loves to own. The commander, instead of riding his own horse, mounted this white horse to lead his troops back into the city. The wardrobe was hauled into his official residence, where it was then sealed with an official tape issued jointly by him and the warden. Soldiers were to guard it until dawn, when they could memorialize to the king to see about its disposal. As the other troops retired, we shall leave them for the moment. We tell you instead about the elder Tang inside the wardrobe, who complained to Pilgrim saying, "You ape head. You've just about put me to death. If we had stayed outside and been caught and sent before the king of the Dharma-destroying kingdom, we could still argue with him. Now we are locked up in a wardrobe, abducted by thieves, and then recovered by government troops. When we see the king tomorrow, we'll be ready-made victims for him to complete his number of 10,000. Pilgrim said, "There are people outside right now. If they open the wardrobe and take us out, we'll either be bound or hanged. Do try to be more patient, so that we don't have to face the ropes. When we see that befuddled king tomorrow, old monkey has his own way of answering him. I promise you that you'll not be harmed one whit. Now relax and sleep." By about the hour of the third watch, Pilgrim exercised his ability and eased his rod out. Blowing his immortal breath on it, he cried, "Change!" And it changed into a 3-pointed drill. He drilled along the bottom edge of the wardrobe 2 or 3 times and made a small hole. Retrieving the drill, he changed with one shake of his body into an ant and crawled out. Then he changed back into his original form to soar on the clouds into the royal palace. The king at that moment was sleeping soundly. Using the grand magic of body division in the assembly of gods, Pilgrim ripped off all the hairs on his left arm. He blew his immortal breath on them, crying, "Change!" They all changed into tiny pilgrims. From his right arm, he pulled off all the hairs, too, and blew his immortal breath on them, crying, "Change!" They changed into sleep-inducing insects. Then he recited another magic spell, which began with the letter O, to summon the local spirits of the region into his presence. They were told to lead the small pilgrims so that they could scatter throughout the royal palace, the 5 military commissions, the 6 ministries, and the residences of officials high and low. Anyone with rank and appointment would be given a sleep-inducing insect, so that he would sleep soundly without even turning over. Pilgrim also took up his golden hooped rod. With a skeeze and a wave, he cried, "Treasure, change!" It changed at once into hundreds and thousands of razor blades. He took one of them, and he told the tiny pilgrims each to take one, so that they could go into the palace, the commissions, and the ministries to shave heads. Ah, this is how it was. Dharma King would the boundless Dartna destroy, which fills the world and reaches the great way. All Dharma causes are of substance one. Trayana's wondrous forms are all the same. The jade cupboards drilled through, the truth is known. Gold hairs are scattered and blindness is removed. Dharma King will surely the right fruit attain. birthless and deathless, in the void, he'll remain. The shaving activities that went on for half the night were completely successful. Thereafter, Pilgrim recited his spell to dismiss the local spirits. With one shake of his body, he retrieved the hairs of both his arms. The razor blades he squeezed back into their true and original form, one golden hooped rod, which he then reduced in size to store in his ear once more. He next assumed the form of an ant to crawl back into the wardrobe before changing into his original appearance to accompany the Tang monk in his confinement. There we shall leave them for the moment. We tell you now about those palace maidens and harem girls in the inner chambers of the royal palace, who rose before dawn to wash and do their hair. Every one of them had lost her hair. The hair of all the palace eunuchs, young and old, had also vanished. They crowded outside the palatial bedchambers to start the music for waking the royal couple, all fighting hard to hold back their tears and not daring to report their mishap. In a little while, the queen of the three palaces awoke, and she too found that her hair was gone. Hurriedly she moved a lamp to glance at the dragon bed. There in the midst of the silk coverlets a monk was sleeping. Unable to contain herself, the queen began to speak, and her words awoke the king. When the king opened his eyes, all he saw was the bald head of the queen. "Sitting bolt upright," he said. "My queen, why do you look like this?" "But my lord is also like this," replied the queen. One touch of his own head sent the king into sheer panic, crying, "What has become of us?" In that moment of desperation, the consorts of six halls, the palace maidens, and the eunuchs young and old, all entered with bald heads. They knelt down and said, "Our lord, we have all become Buddhist priests." When the king saw them, tears fell from his eyes. "It must be the result of our slaughtering the monks," he said. Whereupon he gave this decree: "You are forbidden, all of you, to mention your loss of hair, for we fear that the civil and military officials would criticize the unrighteousness of the state. Let's prepare to hold court at the main hall. We tell you now about all those officials, high and low, in the five commissions and six ministries, who were about to have an audience with the throne at dawn. As each one of them, you see, had also lost his hair during the night, they were all busily preparing memorials to report the incident. Thus you could hear that?" Three times the whip struck as they faced the king. The cause of their shorn hair they would make known. "We do not know what has happened to the stolen goods recovered by the commander of the government troops. Let's listen to the explanation in the next chapter."